it's not like you, God, who's the judge of all the earth, not to do the right thing. You're going to kill righteous folk with the wicked folk? That's not like you. He said, if we can find 50, will you spare the city? Then watch God. God has always been a God of grace. He said, yes, if you find 50, I'll spare.
Yes, sir.
Well, he couldn't find 50. He came back and said, God, if you can find 45. Lord, if you can find 45, can we spare the city? He said, yep, 45, I'll spare them. Had to come back. He said, what about 30? He said, yep, 30. What about 20? Yep, 20. He got all the way down to 10.
Yes, sir.
To 10.
Yes.
That's not very many. But the Lord said, if you find 10 in Sodom and Gomorrah that are righteous, I will spare the whole city. Let me help you understand how this thing works. If y'all don't mind, I need some folk to stand up for me. Bro, can you stand up? Stand up. One, can you stand up? Two, three. Brother McClain, I'm going to let you in. Four. Brother Scruggs, five. Lisa, six. Come on. Pam, seven. Michelle, eight. Sis, nine. Sorry, bro, I'm going to be in this number 10. Now, look at this. 10 folk. If I find 10 in Nashville that are righteous, done, that are righteous now, if I find 10, I'm going to spare all of Nashville, Murfreesboro, Smyrna, Antioch, all of that. I'm going to spare them if I can find 10 righteous. Y'all can take your seats. That's not very many. And God has never needed very many to do his bidding. Am I right about it? But the key there was, if I can find 10 righteous.
Yes, sir. That's the key word.
Now, let me help you with that word righteous. See, we look at righteous as being perfect, sinless. Righteousness in the eyes of God is not perfection as we know it. It's not sinlessness. Righteousness in the eyes of God is fulfilling two covenants. Two relationships. God says, now, if you want to be righteous in my eyes, and if y'all don't remember anything else I say during this night, I want you to remember this. You want to be righteous in the eyes of God. God says, I want you to develop and maintain with me a covenant relationship.
Yes, sir. That's right.
God says, any God territory in your life, any worshiping, any praising going on, I want to be the object of that. I want to take up all the God space in your life. I want to have a covenant relationship with you, and then I'm going to check your love for me by how you love your neighbor. I want you to develop a covenant relationship with me and a communal relationship with your fellow man. If you can do those two things, I will account you as righteous. God says, now in covenant relationship, I want you to love me.
Yes, sir.
God said, I want you to love me. And Deuteronomy 6:5 said, with all thy heart, with all thy might. See, love is not love unless it has a with.
Yes, sir.
Are y'all following me?
Yes, sir.
Let me drop this for the young ladies in here, because y'all seem to need some help. Y'all jumped me last night by something I said about these young men. I told you, when you're looking for a young man, you make sure that young man has a job, he has a name, he has some place to live. Because what he's saying is, I want you to be my wife, I want you to be my woman, I want you to be one with me, so I'm going to take care of you the rest of the days of your life. So therefore, if he's going to take care of you, he got to have some stuff before he can bring you into his life. I ain't going to back off of that. If he's still living with mama, ain't got no job, riding a bicycle, you better let that rascal go. I don't care how much he says, I love you. When he says, I love you, you better say, what do you love me with?
You're right. You're right.
You hear me?
Yes, sir.
Love ain't love unless it has a with.
Yes, sir.
And if he wants you to be his wife, his woman, his helpmate, if he's going to take care of you, then he's got to love you with all that he has. And if he loves you with all he has, he's going to provide for you. He's going to take care of you. But see, what we got now is rascals who want to live off of women.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
don't want to work,
yes,
want to hang out with Pook and them on the corner,
yes,
while you working two and three jobs,
yes,
then want you to come home and cook.
Yeah.
Y'all better say amen.
Yeah.
I'm telling you what we got going on.
Yeah.
If he loves you, then he's got to have a with.
Yes.
And if he's got a with, it needs to be with all that he has. Same thing, young men, if you're looking for a young lady, not necessary that she has a job, but it's necessary that she's willing to support you,
yes,
in your working the job.
Yes,
see, for too long, we've allowed young people to just come together.
Uh-huh.
Just come together. Ain't got nothing ready. Ain't ready. Just getting together. And the best thing they can come up with is, that's just my baby mama. That's my baby daddy. That's foolish talk, church.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
That's not the way God set it up. And God set up the marriage union just like he set up the relationship with himself.
Amen.
He said, I want you to love me with all that you have.
Amen.
Now, when a man and woman come together, he wants both of them to love each other with all. And you're going to find that in marriage, it takes more giving than taking on both parts.
Amen.
I know y'all didn't ask for this tonight, but I'm trying to help somebody. Because, see, families are what's tearing up the church.
Amen.
Dysfunctional families.
Amen.
We've got folk who have quit on relationships,
yes,
quit on parenting,
yes,
quit on working,
yes,
quit on being responsible and accountable, and just living a lazy, lackadaisical life,
yes,
then bring all that mess to the church.
Amen.
God said, if you want to be righteous in my eyes, I want you to love me with all. With all. And then when you say you love me with, I'm going to check your love for me by how you love your fellow man. And so Abram said, Lord, it ain't like you to destroy the righteous with the wicked. If we find 10, will you spare the city? He said, yes, I'll do it. But you know what? They could not find 10.
All right.
They could not find 10. The Lord left Abram.
Mm-hmm.
You know the story.
Yes.
Went on down to Sodom and Gomorrah.
Yes, sir.
Burned that place up.
Mm-hmm.
Only ones got out was Lot, his wife, and children.
Yes.
The city was so wicked that when the two attendants that were with the Lord went before him,
mm-hmm,
the men didn't want,
yes,
the virgin daughters of Lot.
Yes, sir.
They wanted to sleep with the men.
Yes, sir.
That's how wicked those cities were.
Yes, sir.
And you act like you don't know what I'm talking about, but we got the same kind of mess going on even now.
Yes, sir.
The devil is busy in every city, in every state, in every place of the world.
Yes,
he's bringing out unnatural stuff.
Yes, sir.
So the Lord went down there and he told him, y'all leave here because I'm getting ready to burn this place up.
Yes, sir.
Am I right about it?
Yes, sir.
Yes, and Lot and his family left. And he said, then when you leave, don't look back.
Yes, sir.
That's a sermon in itself.
Yes, sir.
Am I right about it?
Yes, sir.
That was old baggage they left in Sodom.
Yes, sir.
And old baggage will get you nowhere.
Right.
Leave it there. And he said, don't look back. And they took off going. But what did Miss Lot do? And she turned into a pillar of salt.
Yes, sir.
Here's the message,
yeah,
with this particular lesson.
Yes, sir.
We stand between the chapters. In 18, he's on his way to destroy.
Yes, sir.
In 19, he ends up destroying.
Yes, sir.
In between, Abram is pleading for humanity, and we must be the same way.
Yeah.
We know folk every day in our world who don't know the Lord, and wickedness has crept into our communities, into our homes, even into some of the churches.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
And I'm telling you, there's coming a day when judgment is going to come.
Yes.
Now, with that in mind, I'm leaving with Lawrence Avenue and all of the other churches in this area. I know you have a daunting task before you. But you need to be responsible and you need to be sincere and honest enough and accept the challenge of meeting the needs of those outside the ark of safety by living the gospel as well as preaching the gospel. And it's going to be done by us demonstrating our faith. You can't get away from that, church. Faith is what is going to bring us to a place in time where we can just keep drawing folk to Jesus.
Yes.
See, Jesus said in John 12, 32, and I, if I be lifted up, I'll draw all men unto me. Well, he's gone now.
Yes, sir.
He was lifted up, not once, not twice, but three times.
Right.
Lifted up on the cross, lifted up from the grave, lifted up back into glory, and he's still drawing men today, but not because he's sitting in heaven. He's drawing through you and me.
Amen.
And when we leave this gospel meeting, when we leave the confines of this building, we need to demonstrate our faith in such a way that folk can see there is a risen Savior.
Yes.
Now I want you to listen tonight to the Hebrew writer.
Yes, sir.
Hebrews 10. Go over and look at verse number 35. Put your finger there. I'm going to run on to Hebrews 11 because Hebrews 11 is the hall of faith.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
And Hebrews 11 gives us a litany of people who were faithful to God all the way back to the book of Genesis.
Yes, sir.
Am I right about it?
Yes, sir.
Hebrews 11. Y'all mind me quoting scripture in here?
Yes, sir.
Hebrews 11 says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for,
yes, sir,
the evidence of things not seen.
Mm-hmm.
By faith, the elders obtained a good report.
Yes, sir.
Through faith, we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that the things which are seen were not made by the things which shall appear.
Mm-hmm.
By faith, Abel offered unto God a more excellent sacrifice than Cain, and by the which obtained witness that he was righteous, God testifying of his gifts by him being dead, yet he speaketh.
Yes, sir.
By faith, Enoch was translated. He was not found, for God had translated him, but before his translation, he held this testimony that he pleased God.
Yes,
am I right about it?
Yes,
and all of us know verse number 6, for without faith,
yes, sir,
it is impossible to please him.
Yes.
He that cometh to God must believe that he is, that he's a rewarder of them that diligently seek him.
Yes,
you know the key to that verse is, without faith it is impossible,
yes,
to please him.
Yes,
and I can quote that whole thing. He talks about Abraham, he talks about Sarah, he talks about Jacob, he talks about Isaac, he talks about Joseph, he talks about the harlot Rahab, he talks about the children of Israel crossing the Red Sea, he talked about Moses, he talks about Gideon and Barak and Samuel and Samson and Jephthah and David, but
yes,
that's not our chapter.
Yes,
our chapter is chapter 12, where
yes,
he says, wherefore?
Yes,
seeing we are encompassed by so great a cloud of witnesses,
yes,
let us,
yes,
run with patience the race set before us, looking unto Jesus,
yes,
the author and finisher of what?
Our faith.
Of what?
Our faith.
Of our faith.
Yes, sir.
He says, we've got folk who went before us.
Yes,
they demonstrated faith. And you know what? They went through stuff that we can't even imagine.
That's right. That's right.
They endured some things that we can't even fathom. We think we're suffering because we got to go back to church. That's not suffering, church. We think we're suffering because we got to get our Sunday school lesson for Sunday morning. That's not suffering. You got to learn to suffer, but suffering is not one of those things. Am I right? Obedience comes through suffering.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Watch. He says, keeping your eyes fixed on Jesus.
Yes, sir.
Now, I want you to back up from Hebrews 12 all the way through Hebrews 11. And go to 10,
uh-huh,
verse 35.
Yes, sir.
Listen to what the Hebrew writer says here. Cast not away, therefore, your confidence, which hath great recompense of reward. For you have need of patience, that after you have done the will of God, you might receive the promise.
Yes, sir.
For yet a little while, and he that shall come, and will not tarry. Now watch this. The just, anybody in here want to be just?
Yes, sir.
The just shall live by faith.
Yes, sir.
But if any man draw back, my soul shall have no pleasure
in him.
Why? We are not of them who draw back unto perdition, but of them that believe to the saving of the soul.
Amen.
You know what the Hebrew writer is saying here, as I'm not even nearly about through. I'm just getting halfway into the real thing here.
Yes, sir.
He's saying to us that we, in the eyes of God, live by faith. He said quitting is not even an option.
You're right.
And the reason I brought this message tonight, and the reason it was so heavy on my heart, is because I think that in many churches of Christ and in many cities around the country, folk who are still on the roll at the building have actually quit on the Lord.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
You might ought to say amen now, because yes, it's not going to get any lighter than this now. I believe that folk have quit on the Lord.
Amen.
It's harder now to lead the lost to Jesus. It's hard to even get visitors in the house. And I wonder, why can't we get folk in the building? Why can't we get folk involved? And I'm wondering what's going on in the membership.
Yes, sir.
Amen. See, there's a quitting spirit in the world today.
Amen.
Whether you acknowledge it or not, there's a quitting spirit. I walked over to the post office today, across from the hotel, just to mail some letters and things, and a man just sitting there camped out, waiting for folk to come in and out, begging for money. We all see it all the time. I've been hit about 3 or 4 times since I've been in Nashville. Pull up to a gas station anywhere, they're waiting on you. And do you not know some of these same folk who are begging, who are homeless, who are transient, who have no place to live and don't care anything about living? These same folk used to be doctors, lawyers, politicians.
Yes,
they used to have good jobs. They had homes. They had families. They had cars. They had money. They had respect. But somewhere along the line, the devil got into their lives and they quit on life.
Yes, sir.
And they've relegated themselves to just standing and begging for someone to help them.
Yes, sir.
Well, I can't deal with them because they out there.
That's right. You're right.
So I'm going to bring it on closer to where we are.
Yes, sir.
I'm seeing a quitting spirit among us.
Yes, sir.
Quitting in relationships.
Yes, sir.
Falling out with one another.
Yes, sir.
When Jesus said in John 13:34, a new commandment I give unto you is that you love one another.
Amen.
The folk needs to, the world needs to see that we are lovers of each other.
Amen.
But we've quit in relationship. We fall out over some of the smallest, minute, minuscule things, and we'll not forgive or forget. Hold it against folk, go all the way around the building to avoid hugging somebody's neck, shaking somebody's hand, and you wonder why we can't draw somebody.
Yes, sir.
Hello?
Yes, sir.
Quitting in relationship. We got folk who've quit in parenting.
Yes, sir. Stay
there. Allowing the movies and the television and the rap stars and the streets and the video games to raise our children.
Yes,
I'm seeing something now, and I don't mean no harm by this at all, but I just want you to consider this.
Yes, sir.
Many parents now are so detached from their children and their child and the